Hi, in this video, I will explain to you the fundamentals of bioethics, or shall we say, the basic principles behind it. At the end of the discussion, students should be able to internalize the fundamentals of ethics, differentiate legal and moral principles, and differentiate human acts to acts of man. So let's define first bioethics. Bioethics is derived from the Greek word bios, which literally translates to life, and the word ethics, which means moral principles and has something to do with what is right or wrong. So when you combine it, bioethics is the study of moral principles and ethical issues, which is concerned with anything and has something to do with our actions. Another definition is from Babor in 1999. He defined bioethics as the systematic study of human conduct in the areas of the life sciences and healthcare, which means bioethics deals with the behavior of human, especially those who are working in the healthcare setting. In 1991, Agapay also defined bioethics as an attempt to rationalize application and use of the many advances in medical technology, which means bioethics will help us use medical technology and its advances in the right way. The bio part of the bioethics leads us to examine new and recent findings and discoveries from the physical and natural sciences. So, since bio means life, bioethics will help us find new advancement and discoveries in the sciences. Example for this is the emergence of new technologies. Bioethics is also primarily concerned with ethical implications of the discoveries in the field of biology, especially in medicine, which means this subject will guide us on how to apply this advancement in medicine with the use of decision-making. Any healthcare professional should consider the different principles of bioethics in dealing with ethical issues in medicine. So, for the principles, we'll discuss it in our next topic. So, now, we'll proceed with the application of bioethics in life issues. As contemporary human society faces various moral and ethical dilemmas regarding the use of science and technology, humans, as thinking, rational and free creatures, cannot escape exercising options or decisions, especially on areas that concern the so-called life issues. So we all know that humans, especially healthcare providers, are facing different medical and ethical issues with the emergence of new technology. So as we face those issues, we cannot deny the fact that there are certain situations in which it will be hard for us to make decisions, especially when it has something to do with saving lives and wherein those decisions that we will make can affect the image of humanity. So some of the life issues in which our decision will be judged are the following. So we have life issues including genetic engineering, organ donation and transplant, physician-assisted euthanasia or suicide and end-of-life medical decision, abortion or contraception, reproductive technologies, and human experimentation. So these decisions, in one way or another, eventually, they will have an effect on the physical environment, human health, as well as in the quality of life of an individual. So next is we'll talk about bioethics as an interdisciplinary subject. So as a subject where science and philosophy intersect and converge, bioethics properly tackles the various ethical issues and problems arising from progress in biology and in the practices emerging from it. So when you say interdisciplinary, it can relate to more than one branch of knowledge. So in order for us to resolve and be more equipped and ready to face these life issues and concerns brought about the advancement of medical equipment and technology, there is a need to involve various fields such as sociology, biology, medicine, psychology, philosophy, law, and religion, which means during decision making, we need to consider the different principles of these fields. Next is, we will talk about the scope of bioethics. Bioethics covers ethical issues related to the practice of medicine, broadly understood the pursuit of medical practice. So example of this issue is the humans and animals, which are used as a test subject for medical research and experimentation. It also covers problems and issues related to the life sciences and technologies. Example of this are the concerns regarding environment, like the controversial issue before on aerial spraying of banana plantations in Davao City. And lastly, biological aspects of environmental ethics, issues related to non-human and biomedical ethics, which means environmental issues such as how global warming affects biotic communities are also considered biomedical issues. Next is the importance of bioethics. The discipline of bioethics seeks and attempts to provide healthcare practitioners certain ethical guides and principles in solving ethical questions and dilemmas, which were brought about with advances in medical knowledge and technology, which means bioethics will serve as a guide for us in decision-making brought about the dilemmas of using medical knowledge and technologies. Another one, bioethics helps us to be reflective and critical with the advances of science and technology, making sure that they truly serve humanity without disrespecting human life and dignity. In other words, bioethics will help us to reflect within ourselves whether those decisions we made is humane, which means without studying and knowing bioethics, there is a possibility that we will act without considering the feelings and emotions another person or animal. Another one, bioethics is indeed a discipline of practical importance, for it revolves around concrete and practical issues that truly matter in the actual living of our lives, particularly in our pursuit of a healthy and good life, away from bodily sickness and disabilities, as well as free from moral impurities and decay. Which means the use of bioethics has really something to do with the common issues we have nowadays. Example, one of the common ethical issues is contraception or the using of pills or implants to prevent pregnancy. So while you focus on preventing pregnancy, you're also promoting harmful effects in your body because of side effects brought about by the use of pills as well as the implants. So bioethics will serve as a guide in dealing with these issues. So before we proceed to these issues and concerns, let's go back first to the brief history of bioethics. Bioethics had its beginning in 1950s when a small group of physicians and theologians decided to take a closer look at the intriguing questions and problems raised by the advent of new medical technologies. So bioethics began in 1950 after World War II, and it is where they spent the heavy public funds. Soon thereafter, the small group were joined by a number of philosophers and lawyers. Then the term bioethics was first recorded in print in 1970 by Van Rensselaer Potter, an oncologist at the University of Wisconsin, USA, in a book entitled Bioethics, A Bridge to the Future. So this work was based on a reflection on the risk and dangers of man's self-destruction due to what the author calls as the biotechnological delusion of omnipotence, or man playing as God. So in this book, the author realized the impact of the problem and the challenges that the human society was facing during that time. So he wrote in that book that humans need a new ethical framework, When you say ethical framework, it is a set of principles which will serve as a foundation or basis to the safe practice of any profession. So the ethical framework he was referring to at that time was bioethics. So the term bioethics, as adopted by the medical community at the time and thereafter, came to be used in particular to describe the process of examining the ethics or the morality involved with emerging medical technologies and biological research. So the term bioethics was used that time to describe the process of determining what is right or wrong with regards to the use of medical technologies and biological research. So, it is worth noting that a number of the concerns specifically addressed in bioethical studies have historical roots, which means the issues we are facing nowadays are already present before, during their time. So, example of these issues is we have the confidentiality or privacy that characterizes physician-patient relationship, and another one is the issue on animal treatment. So because of the influences, bioethics has taken deep root in academia, which means bioethics is now introduced as a subject. So bioethics are now offered to undergraduates as part of humanities and science curricula and to medical and other health professional students. The discipline of bioethics has many different names in school curricula, such as health ethics, nursing ethics, medical ethics, ethics for the health sciences, ethics of healthcare, and ethics for the health profession. Let's proceed with the definition of ethics. Ethics is a branch of knowledge that investigates the nature of the human conduct. The term is derived from the Greek word ethos, which can mean custom, habit, character, or disposition. So ethics is concerned with what is good for individuals and society, and it has also something to do with what is right or wrong. Next is, it is important that we differentiate human act from the act of man. Human acts are actions that proceed from the deliberate free will of man. In other words, man are responsible for these acts, or shall we say, these actions are therefore done with knowledge and consent and willfully carried out by the person. So human acts are either good or evil. So their morality depends on the object chosen, the intention, and the circumstances. So human acts are characterized as the free and voluntary acts of man, which means they are aware of the act, acts then with knowledge and consent, so they allow that act to happen, and also acts which are conscious and under our control and for which we are responsible. On the other hand, acts of man refer to certain types of actions that are naturally exhibited by man, and as such, they are morally indifferent because we cannot judge them to be either ethical or unethical. So these are the usual action of man. However, acts of man can become human acts when he employs his intellect and will in performing the act. So we have the two categories of the acts of man. First is the natural involuntary actions, and the second is the natural voluntary actions. When you say natural involuntary actions, these are actions of man that are performed intuitively or involuntarily. Example, blinking of the eyes, our body's metabolism, perspiration, and the beating of our heart. Natural voluntary actions, on the other hand, are actions that are within the control of man's will but only for some period of time. Example is breathing, reading, sleeping, walking, and eating. So as I said earlier, there are special circumstances where some acts of man, particularly the natural voluntary actions, may become human acts. Therefore, it may be judged to be either moral or immoral. Example, reading is a voluntary act of man. However, If one reads a pornographic magazine, reading in this case becomes an immoral action. We also have acts in relation to its reason. We have the good acts. These are done by man in harmony with the dictates of right reason. Example is praying. Evil acts are those actions done by man in contradiction to the dictates of right reason. Example, stealing. Indifferent acts, on the other hand, are those acts that are neither good nor evil. Example is digesting the food. We also have the voluntariness of the human acts. The concept of voluntariness is important in ethics because only voluntary acts have moral bearing. This means because human acts are performed by man with knowledge and consent, he is therefore responsible for his actions. For the category of voluntary actions, we have four. First, perfect voluntariness. These are actions performed with full knowledge and with full consent. Example, eating your favorite ice cream or telling a story to a friend. Second, imperfect voluntariness. These are actions that occur when there is no perfect knowledge or consent, or when either or both of the knowledge or consent is partial. Example is signing a contract without fully realizing the consequences or reading the agreement. Third, we have the direct voluntary. These are actions that are intended for its own sake, either as a means or as an end. Example is murder, stealing, and committing adultery. These are never morally allowable, even if the intention and circumstances are good. As the saying goes, the end does not justify the means. And the last one is the indirect voluntary. These are actions that are not intended for its own sake, but which merely follows as a regrettable consequence of action. Example, you went to a party to enjoy with friends, but you made trouble since you were drunk. The making of trouble may have been predicted, but it may have been intended, so it is only indirectly voluntary. Next is the moral principle involved in actions having two effects. A difficult question sometimes arises as to whether it would be morally right to do certain actions from which good as well as bad effects follow. Meaning, is it morally right to do an act which entails good as well as bad consequences? So this is called as the doctrine of double effect. So the answer to this question is yes, provided that one follows the following conditions. First, the action must be morally good in itself or at least morally indifferent. Example, abortion when the mother's life is in danger. In cases when saving the life of a pregnant woman causes the death of her unborn child, it is considered as morally right. Second, the good effect of the act must precede the evil effect. The evil effect is morally allowed to happen as a regrettable consequence. Since continuing the pregnancy would risk killing the mother or putting the mother at risk, it is considered morally right. Third, there must be a grave or sufficient reason in doing the act. So the reason that you have to save the life of the mother is good enough to do the act. Lastly, the evil effect should not outweigh the good effect, or at least the good effect should be equivalent in importance to the evil effect. So in this case scenario, the mother who is at risk was saved. But take note, when it happens in real life, it still depends on the mother or the factors to be considered, such as that premature labor can happen. Next is the determinants of morality. The factors that link the human acts with their norms are called the determinants of morality. It serves as the measure of the goodness and badness of human act. So we have three determinants: the object, the intention, and the circumstances. The objective refers to the natural purpose of the act or the result of the action. Example, the end of action of studying is learning. The intention refers to the intention of the motive of the doer of the act. The motive of the agent varies with different individuals, while the end of the act is always the same. Third, circumstances of the act refers to the conditions that affect the human act by increasing or decreasing the responsibility of the actor. So these circumstances of the act are not considered part of the action itself, which means the act itself can exist even without the circumstances. However, when acts are performed, circumstances affect the morality of the act. So the following are considered circumstances of the act because they can either aggravate or mitigate the culpability of the actor. First, who refers to the person or the one to whom the act is ascribed. Second, what refers to the quality or the quantity of the object of the act. Third, where refers to the place where the act is performed. Fourth, how refers to the manner or mode by which the act is performed. Fifth, by what means. So it refers to the means employed by the actor. Next, when refers to the circumstances of time. And lastly, why refers to the circumstances of end or intention of the act. So according to Paul Glenn in 1968, he wrote 5 principles involving the implications of the circumstances of the act. First, an indifferent act can become good or evil through circumstances. Example, eating meat is okay, but eating meat on Good Friday intentionally is evil. Second, a good act can become evil through circumstances. Example, giving money to poor people is a good action, but giving money to same poor people to buy votes during election is evil. Third, an intrinsically good act can become better, or an intrinsically evil act can become worse through circumstances. Example, visiting a sick person to comfort him is a good action. However, not visiting a mother who is sick in the hospital out of hatred is worse. Fourth, an evil act can never become good through circumstances. Example, stealing money to buy food cannot make the action of stealing good. And lastly, a good act done with the evil means destroys the entire objective of goodness of the act. Example, giving food to the hungry is a good action. However, giving money to the hungry through robbery is evil. So these are the references in making my PowerPoint presentation. So that will be all for this topic, and see you on my next video.